Hey, my name is Erik Reinert, and I'm a senior software engineer. In this Introduction Systems course, I try and introduce you to design principles around backend systems, how and what they are, when you can use them, and common systems like monoliths, distributed services, serverless, and hopefully empower you to take that process from zero all the way to production at any environment you're in. Now we're going to actually go into deeper detail around the, I like to call the main four principles of architecture designs, which is modularity, scalability, robustness, and flexibility. Now, you have to think about each of these individually. You can't just kind of try and lump everything into one. You want to be able to look at your architecture and say, okay, is it modular enough? Am I reusing things in the right place? Are things coupled the right way? For scalability, you want to be able to understand things like, you know, how much traffic are we going to have, so forth and so on. Robustness, is the system dependable? Right? Are we dealing with problems every day? If you build an architecture and you're dealing with problems every day, it might not be very robust, as well as flexibility, being able to support, you know, future changes and things like that. So let's get into modularity first, right? Each component of the system should have a specific task. This is probably the easiest way I can describe modularity for a backend architecture. Maybe you only have one component. That's fine, as long as it solves the one specific task that you need it to. We're not saying that, again, this has to be a crazy distributed platform. It's just you have to be able to say, this component does this, and why does it do this? And that will help you a lot with, you know, your argument, communication, learning, and hopefully it'll get to a point where, you know, it becomes easier to understand and people can say, okay, well, this component's over here. Okay, this component's over here. Oh, I could just use this. Scalability. So the system should be designed to handle growth of traffic, right? So after we talk about modularity, we want to be able to scale those modules individually, right? Is there a certain part of your system that takes more traffic than another? A good example of that is I'm currently working on building a content creator tools platform. And one of the things that we do is we process chat messages from Twitch and other streaming platforms. And for every single message that comes into our system, there may be three or four or five other calls lower down in the system that you need to be able to consider. And that's a big part of it is making sure that you don't have any bottlenecks, anything that will potentially impact system performance and things of that nature. You want to be able to make sure that every module or every component can scale, basically. Robustness. So again, as I said before, the system should be able to handle unexpected situations or errors or things like that. And I think actually this is a really big thing that a lot of people fail at. And the reason why I say that is because more often than not, I noticed a lot of companies do not spend time in proper error handling. Like, how many of you at companies today have errors that you have no idea what they are or what they do, right? What is this error code? Why did it give me a 404? I didn't expect a 404, right? What is unknown error, right? Like that's not robust. That doesn't help you scale a system, right? So it is a really good consideration to think about when you connect two different components together, how's it gonna handle errors, right? How's it gonna receive those errors? How's it gonna respond to those errors? Another big thing that I see a lot is the code itself doesn't handle the expectation or doesn't know how to handle the, you know, specific message or, and then it just crashes, right? Being able to think about that, think about what could potentially break in your architecture is really important. And I would recommend, especially around error handling and things like that, build your own language, right? Nobody, like front end users don't care about your error codes. You don't need to show those in the front end, right? But if you can show better errors to your systems so that they can react accordingly, that just makes it easier for those systems to heal themselves or be able to, you know, continue with whatever they're trying to do. And this one, now this one is very challenging, flexibility, right? I deal with this a lot and I definitely don't think there's a perfect science to this either. What does flexibility mean? It really means that the system should be designed to accommodate changes or future features, right? This kind of depends on how much your company wants to invest into this, right? But the main goal here, and I think a lot of us have dealt with this too, is you don't want to be in a scenario where you have to take one step or two steps back to take one step forward. And I've worked with this a lot in the past where I've gone to a specific system and then I've been like, okay, we want to change this. And they're like, well, to do that, we got to refactor this and then move this around and move that around. And that really isn't a flexible system. That means that that system was potentially designed to solve one problem only, but it wasn't considering the potential changes of the architecture. Again, maybe one system doesn't have the error handling of another system and things like that. So let's define a monolithic architecture. So a monolithic architecture is a model where all the necessary code and components for a software application are combined into a single unit, right? Just out of curiosity, how many here uses monoliths where you work? Yeah. It's probably
intentional,
yeah, it's probably one of the most common architectures that you would start with at a company, or even at a project or things like that. Monoliths are very powerful in their own right by the problems that they solve, how they solve those problems, and how they can help growth of a company. So this is really what a monolith looks like. It's very simple. You have users. They get sent to a specific monolith. It can normally be the front end and back end combined into one, right? And then maybe there's a database instance that's behind that or something like that. But at the end of the day, most projects, most companies start with a system like this. And as I said before, it's normally completely coupled, meaning that your front end and your back end are the same thing. Something like Next.js, for example, that technically could be considered as a monolith because you're doing your front end logic and your back end logic all in one place. And there's a lot of reasons why Next.js and other frameworks like this are becoming really popular because you can move fast. Right. The idea is that in this kind of architecture, everybody's in the same, you know, everybody's in the same seat. We're all working together. We're all modifying or working on the same code. There's not tons of changes with regards to the languages that are being used or the definitions or the libraries or whatever. We're all basically cooking in the same kitchen. And so this is what a monolith can look like if you're working on something like that at a company. So again, monolithic architecture basically has all functionalities tightly coupled running in the same system. So again, if we go back to this monolithic chart, we'll see that the front end and the back end are joined together. And that means that they can be worked on in the same sense. If they need to be updated, they can be updated together and you don't have to worry about going to different places to do so. Why is monolithic architecture so valuable? Well, it's simple to develop, test and deploy due to its unified system, right? You're developing in the same location, all of your tests exist in the same location, and what you're deploying is the same thing, right? Over and over and over again. It's a small, tightly coupled architecture that allows you to iterate quickly and not worry about complications, abstractions, things like that. So the pros, again, simplicity. It's easy to develop, test and deploy. Right? It makes it so that that simple architecture allows you to move fast. If a project comes in, everyone's got a unified understanding of the system, and so that they don't really need to be asking questions even as well as like, how do you do something? It's already there. Normally 9 times out of 10, it's already been defined, and there's a good pathway of how to, you know, how to work on the thing that you're trying to work on. Monoliths are also really great for new hires. You know, you don't have to talk about tons of complexity or things like that. You could just say, well, here's the monolith and here's what we work on. And as you get more comfortable with it, you'll start to understand it more and more.
What's the best way to communicate between microservices?
That is a tough question to answer. mostly because it depends on your transactions and what kind of messaging you need, right? What we're looking at here is a very simple, like restful kind of transactional approach where more than likely what will happen is that a user will make a request to the front end, right? And while this user's waiting, the front end's going out to the user's table, getting the data it needs, going out to the payments table, getting what it needs. And do you remember that reference I said earlier about the guy in the video who's like, but then we gotta go here, go here, da, 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 da. That's the problem. That's the problem, is that at some point, if you even go with this approach, there's somebody's gonna be waiting, basically, for that process to come back and for it to finally resolve and respond. And that's what that guy's talking about in that video, jokingly, is like, it might take 5 minutes for a request to populate properly just because it's so distributed, right? And again, going back to when I was interviewing at Netflix, this was a problem that I was going to be brought on to solve, which is, you know, they have such a huge distribution. How can they avoid the hops to get people in the system quicker, right? And so what you could lean on then is like event-based systems where you say like, okay, we're going to remove the front end and we're going to put like an event bus in front of it. And then everything becomes asynchronous to where one request pops over here. And then once that happens, something else is listening for that request to be done. So then it can then take on its next step. And that just makes it a lot faster in the back end. So you have to be really careful with how even this scenario plays out, because you can easily add a lot of, like, again, going back to the UUIDs doesn't scale. This is actually a good example of that. If you had these two services, but then you got to go to payments and then you go back to users and then go to payments again and then go somewhere else, yeah, you might have a distributed system, but it's not really efficient, right? So it really depends. Again, queues are also really good in the scenario where you want to, you know, say like a good example of that is like asynchronous of processes where you click a button and then it says, okay, we're taking care of your process. Give us some time and go do whatever else you want to, right? That's about building a user experience with your architecture, where in that scenario, you're telling the user, hey, this is going to take a second, but we're not blocking you to stay here. You can go and do something else, and then when it's done, we'll come back. And then that allows all the services to communicate with each other internally, do whatever they need. So there's a few different approaches. The most common one, though, is this approach here, where you have services speaking directly to each other. They have designated endpoints. And again, gRPC, I think, is a really good approach to that. Not only because it works in Go, but gRPC is also available to be created clients for almost any language. So if you had a front end that was Java, oh God, I feel sorry for you. But if you had a front end that was Java, you could technically unify those services with gRPC because Java can create gRPC clients. But again, if that Java service has to make five hops, you might find yourself going on a queue-based system or an event-based system or something like that. That's why we're really not going into that too much in these slides, is because those are a little bit more circumstantial. Most of the time, as long as you're building good isolation, good separation, this is fine. Again, you know, whenever we get a Twitch chat message, we go out to a API for our data, we go out to an API for our AI stuff, and those are separated. But because they're so fast and they are, you know, easy to respond, we don't really worry about it. The latency is maybe like 250, 300 milliseconds. And so that's another thing you have to ask yourself, is how quickly are you concerned about these requests coming through? And if you need to adapt to that requirement, that's a requirement to me more than, you know, something you just think of naturally.